get goofy. Count. Very good evening to everyone watching at a site or watching at home. We hope that you are warm. At Salpi, are you guys warm? Yes, kind of, maybe. All right, we're about to warm up. We're about to get warm as we sing some hot music about being in a war zone. Are you ready to declare that tonight? Come on, even people at Salpi, are you ready to declare that tonight? Yes. If you are ready and you're watching, comment down below on YouTube and say, I am ready. Come on, everyone, stand up. Let's get warm and let's declare the fact that we are in a war zone, but we are going to win this battle. Come on, let's go. Come on, put your hands together tonight. Let me hear you sing it out. Here we go. You are holy, you are holy, you are holy, Jesus. Come on, let me hear you. You are holy, you are holy, you are holy, Jesus. Come on. Come on, here we go. Let your blood restrain all my fears and doubts. Let your glory shine in my darkest night. I will hold my peace as you fight for me and you hear my grief. Let your spirit intercede. You are holy, you are holy, you are holy, Jesus. Let me hear you sing it out tonight. You are holy, you are holy, you are holy, Jesus. Come on, he has chosen us. Have chosen you, not rejected you. Fear not, I'm with you, so do not be dismayed. I will strengthen you, I will uphold you with my righteous love. I called you by name. You are holy, you are holy, you are holy, Jesus. Come on, put your hands together. Amen. Come on, are you ready to sing about the power of prayer? The power of the fact that when we talk to Him, He actually hears what we are saying. Are you ready tonight, Active Youth? Yes. Amen.
Jesus, I know you hear my prayers. I look to you, seeking your face. I know you hear from your dwelling place. Persistently on guard, persistently seeking you. I know as I knock on heaven's door, it will open for me, calling on you, Jesus. You take hold of my prayers, may my prayer be said before you, like sweet incense.
Come on, really think about what you're singing tonight.
Turning bring to you my picked wickedness. You ring from heaven, my sins they were given. My mind alert, I'm listening, praying on all occasions. Persistently on God, persistently seeking you. I know as I knock on heaven's door, it will open for me, calling on you, Jesus. You take hold of my prayers, may my prayers be said before you like sweet incense. Lord, let your kingdom come. Let your will be done. Deliver us from the evil one.
Come on, sing that as loud as you can.
Lord, let your kingdom come. Let your will be done. Deliver us from the evil one. Persistently on God, persistently seeking you. I know as I knock on heaven's door, it will open for me, calling on you, Jesus. You take hold of my prayers, may my prayers be said before you like sweet incense.
Can I just hear you lift it up for him tonight? He is awesome. Amen.
Now that we are able to be here in this place, Lord God Almighty, and also Father God, we thank you for your presence. Your word says, where two or three gather in my name, there shall I be with them. Thank you for being with us today. I just pray, Lord, that today as we hear your word, that we may not be closed off to hearing your word, that our hearts may not be hardened to hearing you speak to us, to hearing you minister to our lives, Father God. But I just pray that you may open our hearts to hearing your word, Lord God Almighty. I just pray that what you want to say unto us today, Lord God Almighty, that we may receive the message. And we just want to thank you for your presence in this place, and we honor you, we give you all the praise. I pray this in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Good evening, everybody. Good evening to the few at Selby. Good evening to everybody at sites, everybody watching on YouTube or Facebook right now. You are awesome. You are super cool, either because you're sitting here or because you're watching right now. So good for you. Hopefully things open up soon again so we can have a big party all together, right? Wouldn't that be cool, guys? Right? Yes? Okay, so if you're watching right now, either by yourself or at a site, get onto YouTube right now, comment down below. You're going to need to, and you're going to want to comment later on as well, so don't miss this opportunity. Get onto YouTube, like the whole video, and comment down below. Be part of the fun, be part of the action, even if you're at Selby. Join on YouTube. Let's even join in on the fun and action, even though we're here in person. All right, so just before we get into things, don't forget there is church on Sunday. Yes, and do not forget to go when you at Selby, when things open up. Don't forget to go to the store and get yourself some hot or some merch. We're going to hail up, right? And they have a lay-by system. So you can actually order the shirt and do a lay-by system. How cool is that? Right? Right? Okay, so let's get into the offering, and then we're going to get into a very short and tall evening right after this. Let's go.
Good evening, Active Youth. I have a very, very real question to ask you tonight. And it is, have you ever been robbed? I have, right? And this is the story. So I was at church, yes, the house of the Lord. And I had over 1,000 rand stolen from me. It was a very painful time of my life, but I'm okay and God provided. But Have you been robbed? Even worse, have you been robbed in the house of God? Now, I'd like to read Matthew 22, verse 21, and it's Jesus speaking, and this is what he says. Give to Caesar what is Caesar's, and to God what is God's. What is God's? Do you know that 10% of any money you receive is God's? It belongs to God. Therefore, how many times have you been in the house of God and robbed him? That is a very real question, right? And none of us like being robbed. Why? Because it's not fair, it's not just, it's not right. But how many times have you gotten on the wrong side of a good God because you've robbed him? And if I work it out, being on the wrong side of good is being on the bad side, which means that robbing God is actually not good for you because it brings curses upon your life. You see, God doesn't need you to pay him because otherwise he's going to go bankrupt. He asks for that 10% so that you can prove your loyalty to him and your love to him. And when you don't do that, you actually just bring curses upon yourself, because without a good God in your life, there is only curses, there is only evil, and there is only bad. And so I want to implore you tonight, trust God. Trust him enough to give 10%, or to give more than your 10%. Why? Because you love God and you don't want to rob him, and you want to show who you are loyal to. Let us pray. Father, we just come before you and we want to first of all repent tonight of all the times where we have robbed you, of all the times where we have not given our tithe to you. And Lord, tonight we want to replace that. We want to replace whatever in our life, including money, is standing in the way of you. And we ask that from this moment forward, every single month, as we earn income, that we would make the decision to give to you what belongs to you. And as a result, just prove our loyalty and our love. We just thank you for this and pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
We can date someone without consulting the Lord, and they misrepresent themselves. They lie to us. They deceive us. And this person's not right for you. And then you get into a sexual relationship with them. Two wrongs don't make a right. You get into a sexual relationship with someone outside of marriage, and then you fall pregnant. And then you have an abortion. Two wrongs don't make a right. This is not a condemnation conversation. This is me saying, hey, we can't do something wrong and then cover it with another wrong. And the Israelites and Joshua didn't make this mistake.
Really funny. Now China's erecting a wall. Really, we call that medicine? So you wouldn't be looked after by a nurse, you'd be looked after by a robot. You know, what in the world are these guys doing? People aren't talking about that too much. Why are they studying viruses to make them more deadly and more infectious?
Like a boss.
come to tonight. So on this side of me, we have
the tall people.
We have the
tall people.
Definitely the tall people.
There we go.
Well, you can see for yourselves, okay? So we have these people. And then on this side, we have these people. So what we're going to do, right, is you're either going to be team short or you're going to be team tall. It's fine. Or you can be in a very, very special category where you are neither tall or short like me. You know, some of us, we are right. It's not about me. So you are either hashtagging team tall or you are hashtagging team short. Now what we're going to do, team?
Team God.
Team short. Okay. So what we're going to do is they're going to give us a joke each. And whichever team you think is funniest, you're going to hashtag in the comments either team short or team tall. Who is starting?
Team short.
Team short is starting. Guys, let's go. Okay. Team short is starting. Short. She said it.
Our first joke. Thank you. What concert... Yeah. Okay, what concert only costs 45 cents?
Marcus.
No!
The real one.
50 cents.
Nah, that was a funny joke. They're all laughing.
Okay, hopefully this side of the room has a better joke.
Yeah.
That was a serious joke.
I feel like they didn't get the joke.
You guys, okay. So I won't be using a phone or anything else. So
okay.
Naomi, you know when I first entered the competition, you didn't tell me that, you know, I thought that you need to be at least this tall.
Why am I being dissed? I'm not a part of this. I'm neutral. I'm literally neutral. But it's fine. Use me. It's fine.
Yeah, you know, as I was saying, yeah. You know, I thought to be part of this, you need to be at least this tall to enter the competition. But it seems like, yeah.
You want to know what happened?
What happened?
Seems like.
Because Nephilims died long time ago.
The what?
Nephilims died long time ago.
Nephilims.
You can't crack our jokes, though. I thought you were neutral.
I am neutral.
You can't do that to our jokes.
Okay. Sure. Wow. Okay. That was round one. Ding, ding, ding. Round two.
We won.
We're going to try this again. Team Shorts, can we please have a joke? Jokes are meant to be funny.
No, these ones are funny.
Okay. All right. Got you.
Are you ready? Why is Peter Pan always flying?
Why?
Because he never lands. I love this joke because it never grows old.
Come on!
That was good.
Serious
joke,
guys. Because he never lands, and then we like this.
We got it. You know, you ruin a joke when you explain it.
Doesn't make sense.
Tell us the truth. You didn't watch Nice Things.
It wasn't funny. Okay, maybe they don't have context. That's why you thought it wasn't funny.
It wasn't on SABC 1. This thing.
Okay, team tall.
Can I just check, is it one joke each or are we saying five jokes?
10 jokes each.
It's four jokes each.
Four.
So to this side, to that side.
Okay. What happened to the man who invented knock-knock jokes?
He died.
Somebody opened the door.
Outside the door.
He won a Nobel Prize.
That was funny. No?
That was a nice one.
I didn't.
That was good. Okay, Team Shorts, do you have another joke?
We have serious ones.
Mm-hmm.
Someone stole my Microsoft Office and they're going to pay. You have my word for it.
Nice. Team Toll, do you have jokes. A joke for us?
I guess we're one, yeah? Sometimes the best jokes are the shortest.
No, we didn't get that one. Repeat
no, we didn't.
He said, sometimes the...
I'm not dissing.
Sometimes the best bad jokes are the shortest. No?
No.
Okay, all right. Team Short.
Did you not just hear all another joke. Nice jokes?
So, what do you call a belt with a watch on it?
What do you call it?
A waste of time!
Oh! Come on!
Okay, sure. All right.
The pressure is real. Why don't you hire short people as chefs? Because the stakes are too high.
No.
Nice.
Finished.
No.
That was good. This is rigged. How is it rigged?
Okay, carry on.
Okay, all right. How many jokes is that?
We had two.
Yeah. Three. One more.
Oh, okay, go.
What do you get from a pampered cow?
What do you get?
Spoiled milk!
Tring, tring, tring! No, it's real. Bro, why are you laughing if you're saying no?
Okay, moving right along, your last joke, Team Toll.
You wanna go with it? I don't think I have a joke.
Hey, it's finished. It's a good joke.
After I'm not finished.
Yes, after us.
Okay, this is a long joke. It's a long joke. Okay, it's a long one, yeah. So. It's gonna be funny.
It's gonna take forever.
Not forever, okay, yeah. So, in the book of John, no? Mm-hmm. Yeah, the Bible, yeah, okay. So there was this short guy, yeah? So the guy was told by, God told the guy to reach an apple. And if a short guy, if you could reach an apple. So, they told him, if you can reach an apple,
wait.
It will be,
yeah.
This joke is too long. It's too tall.
It's not too long. You guys get it.
Give him a chance. We're listening.
Do we even have the time for this joke?
Yes, you do.
Okay, we're listening.
No, we don't. Yeah. Now, okay, your last one.
Oh, you.
Oh, was that the joke?
Mm-hmm. Wait, what happened?
You didn't find it funny.
No, I didn't. Did you?
You didn't find it funny.
Okay.
Wait, they're laughing.
So,
he's laughing.
So,
he's laughing.
Okay.
You can hear it.
Yeah. All right. So on YouTube, we have Jemima as Team Tall.
Disgusting.
Kumbo as Team Tall.
Disgusting.
And Tsako as Team In Between.
What kind of?
Tsako as Team Vusi. Pastor Gavin as Team?
Short.
Team Short. So I feel like because our partner has decided.
We had the most votes.
So for this segment, I think. Because it is what it is. Team Short.
Tor.
Yay! We had serious jokes.
All right. So for the next segment, we're going to be doing what if scenarios. Okay. So Team Short. Team Tall. Cynthia, you are dying and the medication to save your life. No. No, Lean. No. You are dying.
No.
Lean.
This competition.
No. This
I'm
is
sensing some. If we find some
okay, but you understand when I finish it.
No, but why did you switch?
Because it doesn't apply to her.
Why?
Does the medication apply to my height?
No.
I don't understand.
Can I just say it? Do you want to be disqualified?
Okay, say it.
Okay,
say
so no, Lean, you are dying and the medication to save your life is on a top shelf that you can't reach. How are you going to get the meds?
You can't fly. You can't fly.
Beston said she can't rise to the occasion.
I didn't feel that one.
Nolene, what do you do? This is your life we're talking about.
I'm dying.
You're dying?
There's nothing I can do because I'm dying.
I'll continue to die.
She's dead already.
Yep. Okay. Shadrach, you're stuck in a small room with a hungry and terrifying beast. What would you do to survive and defeat the beast?
Give it one of your legs.
Well, I'm going to feed it.
Feed it what?
What? One of your legs.
You can't feed it your height.
Yeah, I'm tall enough, so yeah.
One of your legs must go.
I don't like that guy.
We're watching.
What do you do?
What do you do?
So Akona K says, awaken your inner gymnastics and climb whatever
tall people in
that
gymnastics.
You'll get there. Mm-hmm. Beston says, feed it to Nolene. Nolene is not in the room. He's alone in the small room.
We can feed Beston.
What do you do?
What do you do?
Okay. All right.
I'm going to skip that one there.
Okay. So Shadrach is not surviving. Vusi, someone shorter than you is mocking your height. How do you respond?
We're on the same team.
Kick him to the side.
What?
Is that your final answer?
No.
Okay. What is your final answer?
I feel like there's an answer in between.
What do you do?
He doesn't know.
Okay, Cynthia, please redeem the people. Okay, so you see the love of your life. Your next response will change everything. What will your response be? Oh, she's going to be quiet. I think she's going to be quiet. So you're not going to respond at
Can
all.
I answer his one, his scenario?
No, yours. Answer yours.
But I have an answer to his scenario.
No, but this is your scenario.
I honestly wouldn't say anything.
You wouldn't say anything? Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Okay, so at Salby, we're going to vote for the second segment. So if you think Team Tall's scenarios, they made it out alive, please shout. Team Tall? Okay.
That's all the short people shouting, by the way.
Team Short?
Boo!
Yay!
Yeah, you're all getting free food after this.
Tonight was a tie because the first segment, because of Pastor Gavin, Team Short won. And then the second segment, because of the crowd, Team Tall won. And...
So
I am the mediator, so I'm just in between. So Kayla can decide who won. We'll call up Kayla.
No, I already know the answer to this. It's not fair. Not fair. Curtain call. Curtain call.
Where is the creativity? What happened to you guys? You both, us medium, know me? Come here. Us medium-sized people seem to have the most creativity. Let's quickly do this. What would you say if you are standing in front of the love of your life and what you say. And then you'll ask me one of the others, and we'll prove that medium-sized people. No, because you can do this. What would you say?
Yes, I'll marry you.
But he didn't ask you.
No.
He didn't ask you. You just
that made
him.
No sense.
That wasn't part of the question. Okay, ask me yours.
Somebody shorter than you is dissing you. How do you respond?
I would tell them to pick on someone their own size. Bam. Okay. So clearly, ladies and gentlemen, tall people are not the answer and short people are not the answer. Us medium-sized people are the answer to this
what?
Problem.
No.
You had, no. You were in a room with a beast and you were going to feed it with what?
His legs.
My legs.
What is in the room? You can just feed it.
Kayla, you know what happened to Goliath, right?
What happened to Goliath? Short people defeated Goliath. I'm just saying.
I think it was medium-sized
no,
people.
No. Because we would be very short with a giant, you know? So
David was young. Was short.
No, he wasn't.
What?
He wasn't.
We have just proved.
There's no one in the Bible that's medium-sized.
We have just proved how you guys have failed. So can we give them a hand? Tall people, short people, get off stage.
Yeah.
You have disappointed all of us. Wow, literally no one could answer the scenario. No one. I am shocked. I don't know what, if the cold, you know what, cold kills creativity, we understand. So we'll give them a chance next time. Maybe we'll do a round two in a few years. Give them a few years to mature in creativity. All right, so just very quickly, we're going to take a look at something that is very important in a time like this. There are a whole lot of people that are sick. There are a whole lot of people that are getting COVID. There are a whole lot of other things going on in the world right now. Like people not having creativity, which is a massive problem, you know, huge problem. But here's the question I want to ask you. Just like short people have a different perspective of life compared to taller people. So let me give an example. I remember once walking in a shopping center with someone that's very tall, and they were taking like one steps, you know, and their one step was like 10 steps for me. And I'm medium-sized, I'm not short. So for the short people, I don't know how they'd respond to the situation. But he was taking one step, and I had to run 10 steps to keep up with his one step. Now, that is a different perspective for short people compared to tall people because it's different experiences. You know, tall people are used to being able to reach for whatever they want, and they wouldn't die because they'd reach for the medication. The short person is used to not being able to reach for things. Either they have to get a bar stool, or they need someone to raise them up to reach for what they're needing, right? So tall people and short people can sometimes have very different experiences, and they can have very different perspectives on life as well, right? Let's take a look at another scenario. You know when you see a girl or a guy on Instagram or on Facebook or on, you know, a dating site, if some of you are on dating sites. I'm not going to look at everyone because maybe in COVID you think that dating sites are your only hope and solution. I will just carry on looking down. But you look at their profile picture, right? And they look fine. That guy has 17 packs, not even a six pack. He has 17 packs. And like the muscles are just everywhere in the right places and the hair is blowing or the hair is just styled to perfection. And then you get this girl and she's just hot. She has all the right curves. She has the makeup on fleek without makeup. She is just like, she is flaming, if you understand. And then you guys organize to meet up, or you organize, you know, in some dating apps, you have these blind dates where you just meet up at the restaurant and you see this person and they're nothing like you were catfished without being catfished because it is the real person. But they look nothing like their profile picture. Or like many guys are saying these days, before you get married to a girl, throw her in the swimming pool. Because for many, the girl will literally, and I think I sent a video to my sister the other day, she looks one way. Now this is not every girl, guys. Some girls wear makeup and they still look like themselves, all right? So this is not against makeup. Girls look fabulous without makeup, and all the girls said, it was only a few of them, but I heard the amens. All right, so she looks one way, right? She looks this way. And suddenly there's contouring, there's added pieces to her face, there's 10 layers of eyeshadow, there's 10 layers of eyelashes, and bam, she suddenly looks like a supermodel, but she doesn't look like herself. In those scenarios, don't you feel hurt? Like, you look like this in your profile picture. But it was the wrong perspective because you don't look like that in real life. You were using nice photo apps to change who you are. Let's take a look at one more scenario, completely different. You know when you're online shopping? Online shopping is amazing. Thank God for online shopping. We don't have to spend hours exhausting our poor legs for no reason. But now, you know when you go onto an online store and then you filter your size or you filter the color you're looking for or you filter shoes or jackets or dresses or socks. If you buy socks online, God bless you. But you literally filter what you're looking for, right? And then it gives you all the things that fall under that category, that size, that those jackets, those socks, whatever it is. You get a different perspective when you filtered because now the site has changed to find exactly what you're looking for. Now, I want to ask you this question. How do you view God? What is your perspective of God? Are you looking at God through filters that are changing the shapes and colors and sizes of God? And that I know he's not different colors and stuff like that, but are you filtering God through a filter of, oh no, he'll always be like this. Oh, you know what? He will let me down eventually. Or are you filtering God through these funny filters that sometimes we use on Instagram and Facebook, and you even get funny game filters that make you look weird for on purpose? Are you filtering God through filters like that? Oh no, I only want God 5 days a week. Saturday and Sunday we'll skip God. Let's filter that. Monday to Friday. What filter are you looking at life through? What filter are you looking at yourself through? Do you see yourself as just messed up and flawed 24/7 or sometimes flawed, or you're only flawed when you don't accomplish what you had planned to accomplish? What type of filters are you looking at God with, and what type of filters are you putting on yourself? Because here's the thing, your perspective of life, how you see everything, is going to determine every single decision. It's going to determine every direction you take. It's going to determine who you marry. It's going to determine who you become. It's going to determine what job you take. It's going to determine where you end up one day when your time is up. What filter are you using? And you know, it's very easy to when things go wrong, look at a filter of, you know what, things suck. Life sucks. Everything is just going wrong. Everything is just horrible. Or instead of being defined by the situation, you can learn to filter through everything through the eyes of, oh no, God is still good. This really sucks, but God is still good. This really didn't go as planned. This was not how I had planned things to go, but God is still good, and he's still working things out for me. He's still faithful. He still loves me. I don't feel that right now, but I don't want to put on the wrong filter. I don't want to deceive myself into thinking I'm getting a hot babe and I'm actually getting Mr. Bean. I don't want to fool myself. I want to see things accurately. You see, here's the thing. When you stop seeing God as good, because Nahum chapter 1 verse 7, the Bible doesn't say things for fun. Just like when the Bible says a guy was hot, you must know he was really hot, because the Bible wouldn't just say someone's hot if they were average looking, you know? So Nahum chapter 1 verse 7 says, God is good. He is a safe place in times of trouble. The Bible wouldn't just say that for fun. And there's a lot of times we're going to go through trouble. I mean, some of you are sick right now. Some of you watching are sick right now. I know there are people watching right now that are recovering from COVID. Some of you have gone through something really hectic at home. Some of you might have a broken nose. Who knows? Who knows? You could have a broken nose. But whatever the situation is that you're going through right now, are you filtering it through the eyes of God is still good? And if I look at myself the past few weeks, I have literally been like, life sucks. Life is horrible. Let's just give up and let's just, you know, stop trying because life sucks. And there were a few times my family would be like, why are you on edge? Why are you down? Because life just sucked. I mean, having a broken nose is fun. You feel like a hero, but well, afterwards, but it's not exactly a fun experience. And then you're hearing of things are getting shut down and things are getting worse. And with the ReActive album recording, oh no, we were limited to lower numbers and then we had to move it. And then people that were coming that I had invited suddenly changed their minds a week later because of COVID. And it was just like, everything is just horrible. And why can't we go back to 2019, you know, when we could just sweat together because there were so many people in church and it was just stuffy and hot. And, you know, a few days ago, my dad phoned me and he said, look, the president is doing a speech. He's probably going to close things down a little bit more. And I was like, okay, cool, expected. There's a lot of, you know, it's flu season, it's winter season. And he just said to me, imagine if this was the ReActive album recording week. I was like, yeah, that's true. A lot more people would be sick. Some of the ReActive team is sick. That would be quite interesting. And he said, you see, things can always be worse. We don't know what's coming. God is still working things out for our good. And I just want to encourage you. I don't know what's happening in your life or what you're going through. You're going to go through things. On Sunday, our pastor said very clearly, you're going to go through trials. It's part of life. The Bible does warn us. God doesn't bring the trials. He will use the trials, though, but we will go through trials. But my question is, what perspective are you looking at? What type of lens are you looking at life through? Are you looking at through life through the lens of, oh, God is still good. Freak, this really sucks. Wow, my gosh, I didn't see that coming. God did, and he'll work things out. But do you look at things through the eyes of God is still good? Okay, he's still working. He's got me. He's still working things out for my good. Or are you looking through the lens of, you know what, life sucks. You know what? I'm tired of this. Or, you know what, I need to be in control. I need to change. I need to take control. No, you don't. You just need to trust God. He'll work things out. And I want to close with this illustration because it's a beautiful illustration. You know, when there's a storm, like a very hectic thunderstorm, eagles actually fly into the storm. And what happens is they use the storm to then help them get to a higher level. So what happens is while they're in the storm, they use that wind to help them get momentum so that they will actually go higher and then they just glide. They don't even have to flap. They don't even have to use much energy. They use that momentum from the wind of the storm to help them glide and just enjoy a nice gliding session and to even go higher than they normally would go with less effort. Whereas other birds, most birds, like chickens and that, especially in a hurricane, they get anxious and they run away from the storm to hide, to find shelter. In a storm, you're either going to be like a chicken, where you're going to get anxiety and you're going to freak out and you're going to panic. This is not going as planned. Oh my word, life sucks. Oh my word, this is terrible. This is just horrible. And you're going to run away from storms and you're going to just complain. And like the Israelites, you're going to keep going around the mountain again and again and again because you're not learning to trust God. You're not learning to run into his arms. You're just falling apart every single time. And that's something I've done for a long time. So there's been times where I haven't been able to walk. I've had to use crutches. There's been times, there's been a few occasions where I have not been well. I've had to recover. I've had to go to hospital, whatever it is. And my mom said to me a few weeks ago, she said to me, do you notice every time something like this happens, you fall apart? You don't trust God. You end up falling apart. You become emotional, you become depressed, or you just get angry. You get angry with God. And I did. For a period, I was angry with God that this happened to my nose. I was like, thanks, Lord. My dad was like, should it happen to someone else? Yes, anyone but me. And my mom just said to me, have you noticed how every single time this happens, you keep going around the mountain? You don't trust God. You don't step back and go, it will be okay. You panic, or you get angry, or you question, or you blame God. And that could be you. Or you could be like the eagle. The storm hits and it's not pleasant. It's not comfortable. It's not what you saw coming. It's not expected. But you use the storm to give you momentum to just glide, to run into God's arms, and to just watch him perform a miracle, watch him show off, and to take you to a new level you've never been before. The choice is yours. But my question is, first of all, what filter are you putting on your life? Are you seeing through the eyes of Jesus? Are you really seeing, taste and see that the Lord is good? Or are you going into control mode, panic mode, depending on understanding what the media is saying or what your friends are saying or whatever, what your own mind is saying? What filter are you looking at life through? Because if it's any other filter that doesn't agree with the word, you're going to start seeing inaccurately. You're going to start putting on Photoshop filters that are going to start changing the curves and the angles and making things look worse or maybe better than they really are. We need to start seeing accurately. So I just want you to close your eyes. Right now where you're sitting, I don't know what's going on in your life right now. I don't know what's happening in your life. I don't know. Maybe things are going really well. Maybe things are going really badly. I don't know. Maybe things are just normal. If you don't learn to trust God now,
when things hit unexpectedly, you're going to fall apart, or you're going to handle it wrong, even if you're not falling apart, because your filter is broken. You've got to fix your filter. How are you seeing life? Are you seeing life through the eyes of Jesus? Or have you put on some, have you downloaded some photo editing apps that are distorting the way you see life and making you see incorrectly and inaccurately? So if you're sitting there right now, and maybe you've been judging how you should act or what you should do based on what doctors are saying, or you've been judging and making decisions based on what the media is saying, or how many reports you're hearing of people getting COVID or people getting sick, maybe your filter is, I don't know, what's happening in your family. Maybe your filter is how you feel. How you feel. It doesn't matter what people or what's happening around you. It's how I feel. It's what I think. It's my opinion. And maybe that's your filter. I don't know what your filter is tonight. I don't know if you're seeing through the eyes of Jesus. But if I can just encourage you, start tonight. Start asking Him to help you see the way He sees. Okay, yeah, things seem quite hopeless right now. A lot of people are sick. We're in a tighter lockdown again. But how does Jesus see the situation? What can we learn from the situation? How can we use this storm to help us glide to a new level? How does Jesus see the situation? Have you asked Him? We've got to start fixing our filter. But you cannot fix your filter and see accurately or see the way Jesus sees and compare your filter to the Bible if you don't even have a relationship with Jesus Christ. You can't see the way He sees if you don't know Him. Just like you're not going to marry someone unless you're on a reality show and you're doing it for the money. You're not going to marry someone you don't know. You're going to marry someone that you love being with, that you know really well, someone that's your best friend. You're going to marry them because you know them. You're not going to enter a relationship with someone you don't know. That would just be stupid and also weird. Now, it's the same with God. You're not going to learn how to see like He sees. You're not going to be able to see if your filter is correct or if it's broken, if you don't even know and have a relationship with the one who has the proper filter, who sees everything accurately, who can see the bigger picture when we can only see the present. So if you have never, ever had a real relationship with Jesus, with this God we're talking about, or you've lost that fire, you've lost that passion, you've lost that closeness that you had, and you want to get it back, or you've made excuses why you'll get serious later. No, I know Jesus, but I'll get real later. I'll get serious about my relationship with Him later. You know what? I'll become more serious about this Christian life later. That's not a very wise way to think. And in the meantime, you're working on a broken filter. Are you sure you'll ever find your way back? Are you sure you're not going to get lost somewhere along the line? If you need a fresh start, or you realize the compass is broken and you've been judging God based on a broken filter, and you, as a result, you've been seeing yourself through a broken filter, and you want to come tonight and you want to start afresh, you want a fixed filter, you want to start seeing the way He sees, you want to actually get to know Him so that He can show you when your filter is, when you're seeing things through like broken glass or dirty glasses or whatever filter, then can I just encourage you to put up your hand right now if you're watching at a site or you're watching by yourself, to comment down below and say, that's me. I want a fixed new filter. You can either email activeyouth@theactivechurch.org if you want it to be more personal, or comment down below and say, Kayla, that's me. And we will get into contact with you. There's nothing embarrassing about this. I shared recently how my filter has been very interesting and I've had to fix it. And there's going to be times where we're going to constantly have to come back and say, okay, I need to fix it. Something's gone wrong. Something's broken the filter. Someone's gone and downloaded an editing app that I don't actually need or want. Then if that's you, just put up your hand or just send that email right now. But also raise your hands in surrender, even if you're by yourself, because it's a time where we come and we surrender the broken filter and we let Him fix our filter. If you raised your hand or you made that decision, then let's all say this together, but I want you to really pray this and mean this with all your heart. Say, dear Lord God, I surrender. I need You. I can't do this without You. I can't fix my life without You. forgive me for seeing you wrong, for seeing you as angry or distant or not caring or unloving or maybe thinking you forgot about me. I give you control. Please fix the way I see you and the way I see life. Flood me with your love right now, that I would experience your presence and the full expression of your love. Please reveal yourself to me. I need you. Forgive me for thinking I could do it on my own. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. So don't forget, if you made that decision, if you're here, please fill out the card and you can chat to Naomi or give it to her. If you were watching at a site or you're watching by yourself, either comment down below or email activeyouth@theactivechurch.org. We want to get into contact with you, so don't miss the opportunity. And with that said, please keep warm, stay healthy. If you're sick, we are believing for complete healing, and we will see you at church on Sunday for Father's Day. Yes? Good night, everybody.
Thank you.
It's your blood.